Can you hear me, sir?
Yes, we can.
So on behalf of endocrinology, we thank the medicine department for having us as a part of your clinical meet, sir. Going to the case, this is the story of a 20-year-old gentleman who presented to us with the history of osmotic symptoms, with history of sweating, polydipsia, polyphagia, and polyuria since the age of 4 years. And he was started on insulin at a very young age. And when he came to us, he was requiring around 68 units of insulin per day. And he was managed as type 1 diabetes mellitus till date. So his main complaints when he came to us were his frequent urination with dribbling of urine and bedwetting. So on examination, we found that he had a BMI of 17 kg per meter square. He had a lean BMI. He had a normal systemic examination. There was no obvious evidence of any micro or macrovascular complications of diabetes, as well as there was no evidence of any insulin resistance. So we went on with the investigations, which showed a high HbA1c of 19.5%, which was indicative of a poor glycemic control. He had a borderline high serum sodium of 145 mg%. His ultrasound abdomen was normal and his GAD antibodies were negative. So given his long history of diabetes mellitus, his fasting C-peptide was fair. It was 2.7 nanogram per ml. His urine osmolality was in fact low. It was 109 milliosmoles per kg. So we did that because of his long history of polyuria and polydipsia. And probing further into the story, he had an elder sister who passed away at a young age of 26 years. So she was healthy till around 8 years. Following that, she had a progressive loss of vision until she was blind. She also had a history of diabetes, young onset diabetes since the age of 9 years. She had history of recurrent seizures from 12 years of age, as well as deafness from 20 years of age. And following long period of poor oral intake and recurrent hypoglycemia, she in fact passed away at the age of 26 years. And this was the pedigree chart of this family. Three is the index patient who presented to us. One is the elder sister, and we can see that their parents were first cousins, suggestive of a third degree consanguinity. And following this, we went in to do the genetic studies, and the NGS panel for MODY genes was first done. The 14 gene panel for a monogenic diabetes was investigated, but all of them turned out to be negative. Next, we went in to do the 17 gene panel for monogenic diabetes, and one of them was in fact came out to be positive. Could anybody guess what the genetic mutation could be and what the diagnosis could be? Would anybody want to try? I think I'll give the answer. This was the WFS1 gene mutation, and this person was having the diagnosis of Wolfram syndrome. Okay, so Wolfram syndrome, this was the fundus picture of his sister's. So sister's eye, as I said, she had a progressive loss of vision and she was blind by 8 years. So this person, this sister was having bilateral optic atrophy. You can see the pallor of the optic disc. This is caused by the retinal ganglion cell degeneration, as well as her audiometry had revealed a high frequency sensory neural hearing loss. Okay, and we found that when we trace back, we found that in this cluster of communities, when we trace back this family, there was a cluster of families within a radius of 30 kilometers who had a high degree of consanguinity. And these people were identified to have a similar genetic mutation. So we identified three individuals from different families who had the same genetic mutation, and this is called as a founder effect. So this was seen in a community with a high degree of consanguineous marriages, and this was from our endocrinology laboratory where we diagnosed a novel mutation in Wolfram syndrome, that is a frameshift mutation where alanine was replaced by serine. and this was called as the founder effect. So briefly, I will just give an overview regarding Wolfram syndrome. We all know that it is the classical Wolfram is the Didmuyat syndrome, which includes insipidus, mellitus, optic atrophy, and deafness. But we also know now that it is a neurodegenerative disorder. The major mode of inheritance is autosomal recessive, though autosomal dominant forms are now being recognized. And the major gene which carries the most highest frequency of mutation is the WFS1 gene, which encodes the Wolframin protein. It is located on the chromosome 4. WFS2 gene encodes the CISD2 protein, and this is rarer, and it includes some other atypical manifestations, including bleeding manifestations and peptic ulcers. So this is the diagnostic criteria of classical Wolfram syndrome. So this included a major criteria where diabetes mellitus and optic atrophy presented less than 16 years of age, and a number of minor criteria including insipidus, sensory neural deafness, neurologic signs, renal tract anomalies, plus the loss of function mutation. And there was a set of criteria that two major or one major plus two minor, or if the mutations were identified, were positive for Wolfram syndrome. But the point we want to highlight here is that Wolfram, just like in our patient, will not manifest all the classic manifestations at the first presentation. They might present you just as a type 1 diabetes, just like a type 1 diabetes. So we can see the center part is the major autosomal recessive classic Wolfram, and on the sides we can see that the mild and the severe. So it's a spectrum of disorders and not just one disorder. And the treatment aspect of Wolfram, we do have certain treatment options if they are caught early. Like we have endoplasmic reticulum calcium. We know that the basic pathophysiology in Wolfram is the endoplasmic reticulum stress. So we have calcium stabilizers where dantrolene has been used, which blocks the ryanodine receptor and suppresses the calcium efflux. We have stress reducers of endoplasmic reticulum like sodium valproate, and we can also use, now we have a new FDA approved drug of butyric acid with tauroursodeoxycholic acid, which will reduce the aggregation of unfolded proteins. So these are the treatment options. So just I would like to say that the take home points from this is that Wolfram is a spectrum of disorders, from classical Didmuyat to exclusive diabetes, which can mimic your type 1 diabetes. And next generation sequencing with a 40 gene panel is critical and precise in determining the diagnosis. So thank you for your patient listening. Dr. Nihal, would you like to comment?
Yes. Thanks for that very lucid presentation, Dr. Prabha. So just a couple of thoughts over here. I think the critical aspect here is that when you have someone who has young onset diabetes, it's very important to draw a good pedigree chart and figure out if there is consanguinity. You should think in terms of a potential autosomal recessive disorder. When you have two family members, and even if they're insulin requiring, the likelihood of it being a pure type 1 diabetes is much less likely. It's more likely to be some other kind of inherited disorder. The other key factor in this particular patient is the C-peptide levels. C-peptide levels in type 1, especially of this duration, will be extremely low, less than 0.5 nanogram per deciliter. This was a low but a detectable C-peptide level. In addition, the fact is the insulin requirements in this patient were much more than a typical type 1 diabetes patient. And of course, the family member having deafness as well as an optic atrophy indicated that this was possibly an inherited disorder with deafness and optic atrophy. So which other disorder can come with diabetes, deafness and optic atrophy? Mitochondrial disorders can also present this way. Now our 40 gene panel can pick up mitochondrial disorders. Having said that, the commonest mitochondrial presentation is that of myopathy and followed by epilepsy. But then you can get patients who come with other neurological anomalies. So that in a nutshell is how you would actually approach this patient. Think about perhaps about 5% of your patients who look like type 1. They could very well have something else, and it's therefore worthwhile. Genetic testing is not only important for the patients themselves, but also for predictive screening. Other patients may come with primary other neurological disorders rather than type 1 diabetes. Thank you once again, Prabha. We'd be happy to answer any questions. I'd like to give credit to the lab and Aaron Chapla and the lab for having done the genetic work in this situation.
Thank you very much, Prabha and Nihal. The schedule, starting with clinicals, National Use Laboratory. Thank you very much. Now it's open for questions and comments. Any questions or comments from comments?
Just one more point, perhaps, since no one's asking a question. We displayed the founder effect. Now, incidentally, the index case came from a Muslim family from Malappuram, and there is a lot of inbreeding in that particular area. The three families whom Krishna Prabha knew, who described, had no inkling of each other. They did not know each other. They were from 30 kilometers away. And so perhaps the founder effect was maybe about four generations before, more than 100 or 150 years ago, when these families, the ancestor, dispersed amongst the community per se. This is, in fact, the first reported founder effect mutation in Wolfram syndrome reported in the world, interestingly.
Thank you, Nihal. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We'll move on. Next patient is from Medicine Unit 1. Will be presented by Reba and Amit Balachandran. Title, Brainy Bitten and Naughty Mitchell. I don't know what that means, but I look forward to every interesting.
Can you put slide? My topic. Title for today is Brainy Mitten and Naughty Mittens. So this is a 53-year-old lady from Pallikonda who presented with numbness of both feet for 1 month, intermittent altered behavior for 2 weeks, difficulty in getting up from sitting position for 1 week, difficulty in walking for 1 week, with significant past history of diabetes for 8 years on insulin glargine and sitagliptin currently. 6 months ago, she also had urolithiasis, which was managed conservatively. 2 weeks back, she was started on antipsychotics for non-specific abdominal pain. On examination, she had a blood pressure of 130/80, pulse rate of 82 per minute, respiratory rate of 20 per minute, and temperature of 100 degree Fahrenheit. Cutaneous examination showed reddish-brown papillonodular lesions over the forearms and palms with overlying desquamation. CNS examination, she was conscious, oriented to time, place and person. She had right-sided element facial palsy. Sensory system examination showed decreased, fine touch was decreased by 50% over the lower limb up to the knee and upper limb up to wrist bilaterally. Vibration sense was absent in the ankles and knees bilaterally. Joint position sense was absent at bilateral toes and bilateral ankles, as well as bilateral DIP. Pain and temperature sensations were normal. Motor system examination, she had wasting of bilateral upper limbs and lower limbs, normal to decreased tone in all four limbs. All deep tendon reflexes and superficial abdominal reflex was absent. This was the power. She had 4x5 power in the upper limbs. Hand grip was weak. Hip flexion, there was hip in the lower limb, there was asymmetric power. As you can see, other system examination was grossly normal. So clinical syndrome of predominantly acute to subacute peripheral neuropathy, which was asymmetrical with lower limb more than upper limb, distal and proximal muscle involvement, sensory motor involvement involving the large fibers, with asymmetric cranial mononeuropathy, which is a facial nerve, and a probable encephalopathy. So our differentials we consider were Guillain-Barré syndrome, vitamin B12 deficiency, amyloidosis, paraneoplastic neuropathy, sarcoidosis, vasculitis, infections like West Nile virus, enterovirus, tuberculosis, heavy metal poisoning. Her initial blood investigations were suggestive of a total WBC of 6,700 with neutrophils of 72. Platelet and HB were within normal limits. She had normal creat and urea. Her calcium was 10.35, sodium was 130, vitamin B12 was 811, and TSH was 2.4. BBVS was negative. Other electrolytes were normal. CSF examination was done, which showed a CSF glucose of 40, CSF protein, which was high, 97, total WBC of 50 per cubic mm, with lymphocytic predominance of 98% and monocytes of 2%. Cytology did not show any atypical cell. MRI brain was within normal limits. MRI spine showed grade 1 anteriolisthesis of L5 over S1 with bilateral L5 spondylolysis, but otherwise was within normal limits. Nerve conduction studies, her NCS showed a motor conduction which showed reduced CMAPs from left ulnar and both tibial nerves. F waves were normal. Sensory conduction showed SNAPs from both sural and superficial peroneal nerves were reduced. H reflex was absent bilaterally. Blink reflex was absent on the right side. On the left side, it was present. So impression was sensory, motor, axonal polyneuropathy with facial weakness on the right side. CSF other, so we did further investigations on the CSF, which showed CSF culture, MGIT, expert were all negative. Fungal culture was also negative. We did a CSF cytospin, which did not show any atypical cells. PCR for multiple viruses, enterovirus PCR, West Nile virus PCR was all negative. CSF ACE was 2, and CRP was 3.96. Her ANA was negative. Anti-PR3, anti-MPO was less than 2. Serum ACE was 19. Urine spot porphyrin was negative. Anti-ganglioside antibody was also negative. At this point, we were thinking more like a paraneoplastic etiology. On further looking at her X-ray, there was hilar lymphadenopathy bilaterally in the chest X-ray. We did a CT thorax and abdomen, which showed paratracheal, bilateral hilar, and subcarinal lymph nodes. Otherwise, CT thorax was normal. So we plan for an EUS-guided FNA of the subcarinal lymph node. Histopathology showed several discrete granulomata composed of aggregates of epithelial histiocytes, multinucleate giant cells. There was no necrosis. There was no definite caseous necrosis as well. So impression was a non-necrotizing granulomatous inflammation. Her skin lesion biopsy preliminary report showed paniculitis with granulomatous inflammation and lymphohistiocytic aggregates. Again, impression was sarcoid cannot be excluded. So our final diagnosis was sarcoidosis with involvement of the nervous system, paratracheal, hilar, and subcarinal lymph nodes, and cutaneous sarcoidosis. A short note on neurosarcoidosis. Sarcoidosis, as we all know, is a multi-organ granulomatous disease of unknown etiology. Neurosarcoidosis per se is an uncommon presentation and is symptomatically present in only 5 to 16% of patients with sarcoidosis. This is a BMC, this is a study published in BMC which showed nervous system involvement was 7.5% of all the patients who presented with sarcoidosis. So the presentation of neurosarcoidosis, this is from a meta-analysis published in BMC Neurology. The most common presentation of neurosarcoidosis is a systemic sarcoidosis at admission, which is 58%. Primary neurological presentation was there in 52% of patients, and history of sarcoidosis was present in 31%. Isolated neurosarcoidosis is only in 22%. So clinical features of neurosarcoidosis, cranial neuropathy is the most common presentation, of which facial nerve is commonly involved. Neuroendocrine dysfunction with hypothalamic and pituitary involvement can be present. Brain and spinal cord involvement with seizures, generalized encephalopathy, cognitive and behavioral problems, focal neurological deficits, myelopathy or radiculopathy, communicating or non-communicating hydrocephalus, acute aseptic meningitis or a chronic meningitis, peripheral neuropathy involvement with mononeuropathy, mononeuritis multiplex, generalized sensory motor polyneuropathy. It can even present like a Guillain-Barré syndrome kind of presentation. EMG-MCV is usually shows axonal neuropathy. There can also be presentation like myopathy with asymptomatic microscopic nodules, isolated palpable nodules, or acute or chronic proximal myopathy and muscle atrophy. So as you can see, most common presentation is 31 to 55%. There is cranial nerve palsy. In our patient, there was aseptic meningitis, which is 16 to 37%. Peripheral nervous system involvement is only in 17% of all the neurosarcoidosis patients. The test for initial evaluation, history, physical examination with HRCT, these are all to look for other system involvement, electrocardiography, tuberculin test to rule out a TB. Investigations per se for sarcoid, so serum ACE levels in neurosarcoid was increased only in 35%. This is from a systematic review and meta-analysis published in BMC Neurology. Serum calcium was increased only in 9%. ESR was more than 20 in 32%. CSF analysis can show more than 5 cells in 58%, more than 0.45 gram protein in 63%, low glucose in 14%. Then other things that we can see are increased IgG index, oligoclonal bands, increased CSF ACE. Chest X-ray can contribute to the diagnosis if there are any pulmonary involvement. PET CT and scintigraphy can be useful to look for other system examination. MRI of the brain can show parenchymal lesions, meningeal enhancement, mass lesions, cranial nerve enhancement. Spinal MRI can also show dural enhancement. Confirmative diagnosis is by histopathology. This
can
is the
concluding slide, please. Take home points and learning points.
So, learning points. Neurosarcoidosis is a rare presentation of sarcoidosis. In that, peripheral neuropathy is a rarer presentation only in 17% of people, 7.5%. High clinical suspicion is needed for diagnosis of neurosarcoid.
Thank you, Reba. That was interesting. I have a question while others are coming up with their questions and comments. She presented with the isolated peripheral nervous system involvement, cranial neuropathy and peripheral neuropathy, and skin lesions. So
yes.
Neurosarcoidosis is rare, and neurosarcoidosis is presenting only as neuropathy is even rarer. And she's a long-standing diabetic. When you
yes.
hear of poopies, you should always think of horses and not zebras. So why is it not diabetic peripheral neuropathy? How did you conclude that this peripheral neuropathy is a manifestation of sarcoidosis and not diabetic peripheral neuropathy?
In this patient, there was the presentation was very acute within 2 to 4 weeks. Prior to that, there was no significant peripheral neurological symptoms for the patient. Also, she did not have other features of diabetes, the complications of diabetes like retinopathy or nephropathy. So these are the things that was favoring towards a neurosarcoidosis with a tissue diagnosis of the lymph node and the skin lesion showing granulomata. We attributed the peripheral neuropathy is most probably due to neurosarcoid.
No, I agree. She had cutaneous sarcoidosis. I'm not disagreeing that. And diabetic neuropathy, I'll ask Nihal, can it present acutely, Nihal? Can diabetic neuropathy present acutely?
Yeah, thanks for that question, OC. So rarely you can get acute polyneuropathies coming in diabetes. Having said that, I think what could have happened here is the diabetic underlying diabetes per se, which was possibly uncontrolled, could have accentuated the progression of what was underlying over here. That's a possibility. Leading on from that, I have a question. How was the response to oral prednisolone in this patient?
Following prednisolone, she actually had improvement. In the ward, she developed a bilateral vocal cord palsy, initially right, followed by left also, because of which we had to pulse the patient. She was given IV methylprednisolone for 3 days, following which she had improvement in her vocal cord paralysis, which was confirmed by a laryngoscopy, which showed improvement in the right vocal cord palsy. She also had improvement in power of her left lower limb, which had worsened while in the ward. It had become 2x5 power while in the ward. She had improvement of that. Actually, I saw the patient on review after 1 week, and she was requiring two people support to walk with a power of 3 to 4 in the lower limb, which has improved during the review. She is able to work with 1% support currently.
Yeah, thanks for that. I think, in fact, when you mentioned that, I was glad that you have used pulse dose methylprednisolone. I guess for these more subacute presentations, whether that would be the first form of treatment to use and perhaps even augment it with something like methotrexate at the same time. Thank you.
Thanks.
I would like to hear from Amit, the consultant, Amit Balchandran, ADC.
Yes, sir. So just like you mentioned, initially we actually disconnected the two syndromes that she had. One was the leptomeningeal involvement with an encephalopathy, and second was this rapidly progressing peripheral neuropathy, which is asymmetrical and involving both sensory and motor systems. In fact, the initial history that we got was only that of an altered sensorium, which was progressive. And once she became a slightly better in the ward after correction of electrolyte abnormalities, is when she gave this history of ascending kind of a paralysis, element paralysis. Then we looked back, put one and one together, and went by Occam's razor, and that's when we thought of a disease that involves both the leptomeninges and peripheral nerves together. And like Reba said, we could not attribute the neuropathy just to diabetes because there were no other microvascular complications that we could find. In the ward, she had progression of lesions, she had new skin lesions, she had involvement of the vocal cords. The element facial palsy actually developed in the ward. That's when we knew that this is something that is rapidly progressing and which is active. And then that is when we searched for, sarcoid was one of the differentials. We searched for sarcoid elsewhere. And then we found these nodes and biopsy showed non-caseating granulomas. In fact, we had to decide to pulse her even before the biopsy reports were available. We just had evidence of non-caseating granulomas in one of the skin biopsy, which could have been very well be a granuloma annulare or something like that. But when she had that rapid worsening on a Sunday morning, we had no other option than to go ahead and pulse. And that actually worked. By the next day, she was up and about and back to her baseline neurological status. And on follow-up right now, she's doing quite well, actually. So, and yeah.
Thank you very much. Very interesting case. Usually for the non-neurological manifestations, sarcoidosis, the response to steroids is pretty gratifying and pretty rapid. So here, this patient still needs assistance. So anyway, let's follow her up and see. Thank you very much. In the interest of time, we will move on. Next presentation is from Medicine 2, Adarsh and Amit Mandal. It's titled, Who Do You Need? Adarsh, please go ahead.